In this video, I want to lay the core groundwork for you understanding time and space complexities. At the end of a problem, when you're finished solving it, often you're going to be asked, what is the time and space complexity of this? Don't wait until the end to describe that. Always make that the constant driver of discussion all the way through the process, because the time and space complexity of any solution you're either weighing in your head or you're implementing, it's always going to be something you want to consider the trade-offs of, discuss them. So the key thing is that you have this discussion of trade-offs and possible other solutions. There's always multiple solutions. There's not always one. This is an ongoing thing. It's not something where you just wait until the end and then they say, what's the time and space complexity? And then you just say, oh, event or something. This is something you constantly want to be thinking, discussing, saying, this is something I'm thinking about, right? I see every video as a tiny building block, and this is one of those first building blocks I want to lay. Let's put a code sample right there. In this example, we have a for loop that runs 10 iterations, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And it won't do 10 because 10 is when it's going to be equal to, and we have a less than sign. So 10 iterations, and we could also just calculate that by doing upper bound, which is n minus 1, minus the lower bound, which is 0, plus 1, which is to take into account the fact that we're including the upper bound, and then that'll give us the amount of iterations. Don't get confused by that. We're going to go into actually solving the math later in another video. That's just a way to look at a for loop and know how many iterations. I want to ask you, what is the time complexity of this sample? More so, this is not a difficult question if you're experienced in this stuff, but I want to direct your attention to what really matters here. What is pulling the strings when it comes to the work that our piece of logic is going to do? What is modulating that? The thing is, the core thing that changes that is our parameters. That's where we should look first. Our segment of logic is parameterized by those parameters. They're the things that change the work. The core question when you're thinking of complexities is, as an external caller to this function, what can I change to change the work happening in this function? If we shift that question to this code sample, we realize that if I'm an external caller, there's nothing I can do to change that. I can't do anything. I can make n a million, I can make it a billion, but I won't change what the line of work looks like. It stays constant. But we know what that is. That's O of one time, constant time. So when we have a piece of code where changing the size of the input, very, very large, won't matter, that segment of logic, and I keep saying segment of logic because every segment of logic behaves differently as compared to the input, that segment is going to run in constant time. The work graph stays constant. And we're gonna get deeper into this in other videos, but I'm just laying the groundwork in this one. How about this piece of code? What is the time complexity of this one? It runs n iterations. So our upper bound is n minus 1 minus 0 plus 1. That just becomes n. So what is the time complexity? Well, the time complexity is just O of n. It's linear time. But what about now? Well, we are doing 2n iterations, and our time complexity stays to linear time. But why does it do that? We're doing 2n iterations, and if we look at the graph of work before, it would have looked like this. But now we're increasing the slope of the graph. But the behavior is the same. The behavior is linear, so it's still linear time, which is O of n. Basically, what we learned in this video is what really matters when we're calculating time complexities is our parameters. Our parameters change how our code behaves and how much work it does. The measure of asymptotic complexity of these time and space complexities is how much work does my code do, how much space does it take up as my inputs change. So I just want to train you to start noticing what's very important. And now we're next going to look into the different classes of time complexities, the different behaviors you can expect, the most common ones you're going to see, and we're going to delve into deeper nuances. We're going to delve into, what if I have recursive functions? How do I solve those? How do I solve the recurrences? If I have a special input and it changes the way my code runs internally, how do I handle that as well? We're going to look into that as well, right? Over time, you're going to notice certain data structures, certain subroutines are going to have a similar runtime. They're going to have shared runtimes. As you practice more and more with problems, you're going to become acclimated to evaluating runtimes very quickly. You're going to know certain data structures have very similar runtimes, certain subroutines have very similar runtimes, and you're just going to become quicker with it. But sometimes you can't just look at the code and know the runtime. With certain recursive algorithms, you're going to have to actually solve out the runtime or just have already known the runtime going in. But we're going to do all of that. Don't worry about it. I just want you to take away that the parameters are the key things to look at. So in the next video, we're going to take a much deeper look into what time complexities really mean mathematically. What are our upper bounds, our exact bounds and lower bounds really doing? And what do they mean to us when we're evaluating efficiency of an algorithm? That's what we're going to look at next.